Have you ever wondered why an individual or group acts or behaves in a certain way? And how their beliefs or ideologies can either positively shape or negatively distort their worldview? I'm going to take you on a journey from the past up to the present and cover a controversial issue that for far too long has been ignored and unchallenged. On this journey, we're going to cover a number of topics that include world empires and show how past events have played a central role in shaping the modern world, including the way that we think. We will look at the men who worked tirelessly to unlock the secrets of the past by deciphering the pictographic scripts and languages of Africa and the Orient. Our journey starts at London's Embankment Station in the city of Westminster. As you walk outside of the station and cross the road, you will see the River Thames. But all the benches are adorned in Egyptian-style sphinxes. Why is that? As you keep walking along the Thames, you see a huge sphinx-like statue in a pharaonic headdress and a lion-like body. This is one of two sphinxes, but they are guarding something quite big. It is an obelisk from Egypt made of Aswan granite, with a height of about 69 feet, a diameter of 7.5 feet, and weighing around 22 tons. It is quite an interesting sight to look at. It is huge, and it has on it a history of how it was transferred from Egypt in North Africa to England in Northern Europe. It reads that Muhammad Ali, viscera of Egypt, gave it to the British Empire as a gift. But why did he give it to England as a gift? What was in aid of, and who originally erected this obelisk, and who carved on it the hieroglyphic inscriptions? In London's British Museum, there is a painting of Pharaoh Ramses II and his two sons in a chariot, warring against the Nubians in the south. He was known as Pharaoh Ramses the Great because of his colossus monuments and his military skills and prowess, and it is his name that is carved on that obelisk in London, England. But about 200 years before he was on the world scene, Pharaoh Thutmose III of the 18th Egyptian dynasty was the one who officially erected that obelisk in Egypt. He was an able soldier, an administrator, and an athlete who was known for his prowess with the bow. And after thousands of years, his monument still stands to this day. Muhammad Ali Pasha was an Albanian commander in the Ottoman army who rose to power and is credited as the founder of modern Egypt for his economic, military, and cultural developments. It was he who gave the obelisk as a gift to the English, and inscribed on the monument is the name of Vice Admiral Horatio Lord Nelson, the British flag officer in the Royal Navy, famous for his naval victories against the French during the Napoleonic Wars. There is a huge monument dedicated to him in London's Trafalgar Square, where his statue stands on top of a pillar in memory of the Battle of Trafalgar in 1805. Though England was a slave-holding nation, many blacks were a part of the Royal Navy, as this figure in the top left of this monument confirms. But these wars against the French changed the course of world history. Britain under King George III lost its 13 colonies during the American War of Independence, and France played a big role in that defeat. French forces invaded a British-owned island on January 6, 1781 at the Battle of Jersey in an attempt to crush the base for British privateers who posed a threat to French and American shipping in the Anglo-French Wars. The French failed and were defeated by the British. The French were to experience another defeat. In the French Caribbean island of Haiti, the black African slaves took part in a slave revolt where they outsmarted and defeated the English, Spanish, and the French, and this was a great economic blow to the French leader Napoleon Bonaparte, who had to sell the state of Louisiana to the United States to cover his costs. At the Battle of Trafalgar on the 21st of October 1805, the English defeated the combined fleets of the French and Spanish navies that was to put Britain on the map as the world's leading naval power. But 10 years later in 1815, on the 8th of June, at the Battle of Waterloo, the British were again to defeat the French under Arthur Wellesley, the Duke of Wellington. something happened that tipped the balance in Britain's favour. An individual used his economic power to shape the course of world history. His name is Nathan Mayer Rothschild, who was once the wealthiest man on earth. This German-born Jewish banker stationed in London used his accumulation of wealth to finance the British government and her allies to defeat Napoleon Bonaparte. There are a lot of wild speculative conspiracies concerning the Rothschilds, but their own website confirms that they helped finance the war, so this is open knowledge for the whole world to see. Following the divine mandate of two or three witnesses, London's Daily Telegraph, voted as the newspaper of the year, also verifies this important role in history. The article reads that during the Napoleonic Wars, Rothschild helped the British government send funds to its allies, while an elaborate network of agents and couriers meant the bank also became responsible for providing money to the Duke of Wellington's army in Portugal and Spain. In the Financial Times of London, it records that Nathan Rothschild informed a head of other traders that the country was not to be overrun by the French, consequently made a killing by buying British government bonds. It is absolutely imperative that you have a thorough knowledge of history. It will help you to understand how the modern world functions, how the media, education and government and relations between nation and states works. In a book titled History of the Ottoman Turks, you will understand why the Egyptian government appreciated the British. Sir Edward Creasy said, "War broke out between France and Turkey in 1798, in consequence of the attack which the French Republic, or rather Napoleon Bonaparte, made on Egypt. His victory over the Mamelukes at the Battle of the Pyramids on the 21st of July and the submission of Cairo 6 days after the battle seemed to ensure the realization of the dazzling visions which had led him across the Mediterranean. But on the 1st of August, Nelson destroyed the French fleet in the Battle of the Nile. The monuments of Egypt have stood the test of time. Their engineering genius and mathematical skill still baffles the modern architect, for it disrupts the evolutionary timetable as they scratch their heads in amazement that thousands of years ago, mortal men hewed out rock with such a high level of ingenuity that still has not been matched to this very day. Napoleon Bonaparte once stood here at the height of his power, staring the Sphinx in its face. He temporarily controlled that North African nation and weakened the already declining Ottoman Empire, where he defeated the Egyptians at the Battle of the Pyramids on July 21, 1798. Though he had a few losses, the Ottoman Empire lost thousands of its men, and Napoleon looked like he was on his way to becoming a leading conqueror. But 1 month later, the British naval fleet under the command of Horatio Nelson was to defeat the French at the Battle of the Nile. This crippled France's control over Egypt, and though there were squabbles between England and Egypt, Muhammad Ali gave this monument to the British government as a gift, and it is a towering symbol of their defeat over the French. The French, when defeated by the British, had to hand over all their Egyptian artifacts to the British. So Charles Joseph de Goua, a French general, quickly wrote down all the symbols of a specific artifact so the French could be the first to decipher it. The spoils were eventually handed over to the British, and it was in the care of British General John Healy Hutchinson, the second Earl of Donoughmore, and he had in his possession an artifact that was to unlock one of the secrets to the ancient world, the famous Rosetta Stone. And it is housed in a building that has on display some of the most priceless artifacts from all over the world, London's British Museum. It was founded by Sir Hans Sloane, an Irish-born British physician of Scottish ancestry, whose collection of books, manuscripts and curiosities and his early collection of plants and insects in the Caribbean island of Jamaica formed the basis of the British Museum. There are monuments around England, particularly in London, that confirm this. And on Bloomsbury Place, where he once lived, his house has a plaque on it to confirm this and verify that this physician started this museum. Our knowledge of the earliest cultures and civilizations, especially in Africa and the Middle East, is as a result of the artifacts that are contained in here. But the culture that draws the greatest attraction is without question ancient Egypt. They preserved and documented their culture and history with such detail like no other. Their architectural achievements doesn't quite fit into early man being a primeval savage. The intricate carving into granite still baffles engineers, and they struggle to fit it into their timetable. Their culture still has an impact on the world today. Herodotus tells us that Osiris was the most worshipped deity in ancient Egypt. He was usually painted as green, probably as a symbol for nature, but he was sometimes depicted as black. There are shoe brands named after him, as well as trendy glasses that have been branded after his name. To the video game culture, there is a game that includes his name. So even after thousands of years after that pagan culture fell, its deity is still revered. The eye was a common symbol in ancient Egypt, and one of the world's major resources for the study of medical history, the Wellcome Library in London, has the same eye on its front building. Harrods is known as the most famous department store in the world. Situated in London, England, as you walk throughout the store, everywhere you go, especially on the escalators, the whole design has Egyptian religious motifs everywhere. Walking through it, you feel like you're going back into time. But one of the most controversial studies of ancient Egyptian history is, what race were they? This is an era of contention that will never be resolved. Sometimes you may look at an artifact and the features look very strongly African. But other artifacts, the features look strongly Eurasian. Some of the mummified bodies have straight light brown hair. But other images look like black women with black curly hair. It is difficult, and the narrator will leave that to the experts to battle it out among themselves. But what has fascinated many in the West for years is its alphabetic script that is very pictorial. The Egyptians called it the Medu Neter, the writing of the gods. But we call it today hieroglyphics, probably from the Greeks that means sacred carving. They also had two other alphabetical scripts that has been called hieratic and demotic that looks like a form of early handwriting. The first attempt in the West to decipher Egyptian hieroglyphs was by an Italian Renaissance humanist, Piero Valerino Bolzano, who in 1556 published a treatise on the sacred writings on the Egyptians called Hieroglyphica. He was followed in the following century by a German Jesuit priest and occultist, Athanasius Kircher, the father of modern broadcasting. When you walk into a cinema and are mesmerized by the quick scenes, storyline and special effects and the surround sound, this can be traced to Kircher's Jesuit theatrics. He wrote many works on Egyptian history, and he attempted to decipher the ancient language of Egypt, and his attempts are on display in the British Museum alongside another man who built upon his works. In Welbeck Street in West London is the house of Thomas Young, an English physicist and physician. He gave the word energy its scientific significance, and before he was 20 years old, he studied French, Italian, Latin, Greek, Hebrew, Syriac, Chaldee, Samaritan, Arabic, Persian, Turkish, and Ethiopic. You don't get minds like that today. In 1801, he discovered the wave theory of light and the principle of interference of light. In 1793, he explained the mode in which the eye accommodates to vision at different distances and that color perception depends on the presence in the retina of three kinds of nerve fiber that responds respectively to red, green, and violet light. He made many different contributions, but it was Egyptology by deciphering the Rosetta Stone is where he helped the world understand the ancient Egyptian language. This replica of the Rosetta Stone shows it was in three languages: Greek at the bottom, Egyptian Demotic in the middle, and hieroglyphic at the top. Thomas Young was the first to correctly decipher any Egyptian hieroglyphs correctly, and he laid the foundation for the science of Egyptology, and he deciphered one of the most common of the glyphs. The water ripple in water was to become a sound value in the Egyptian alphabet. This is one of the oldest Egyptian language hieroglyphs, whose sound value is equivalent to the letter N in the English language, as a phonogram and as a preposition. It is seen on some of the earliest Egyptian artifacts that are on display in the British Museum. This manuscript is of a Frenchman who built on Young's foundation. His mentor was a Frenchman named Antoine Isaac, a linguist, orientalist and journalist, and rector of the University of Paris and member of the American Antiquarian Society. His student was Jean-François Champollion. He is the man who is usually credited with deciphering the Rosetta Stone and giving us a full picture of the ancient Egyptian language and their culture. When he died, his work was continued by his other mentor, his older brother, Jacques-Joseph Champollion, a French archaeologist and linguist. You don't get solid intellectuals like that today, but they helped us in our understanding of ancient Egypt. Everything about the Rosetta Stone and how it was deciphered is documented in a book titled The Rosetta Stone by the late E.A. Wallace Budge, where he gives a history of how the stone came to England and was deciphered. He said that meanwhile the British forces had gained many victories over the French in Egypt, and after the capitulation of Alexandria, all the antiquities which the French had collected in Cairo and Alexandria and had packed up ready to transport to Paris were surrendered to them. The famous stone, which even at the time was generally known as the Rosetta Stone, was among them, and it arrived in England in February 1802. Today, the Rosetta Stone is one of the best known and most famous monuments in the world. The decipherment of the Egyptian text on the Rosetta Stone opened up a new and vitally important field of study to the historian and philologist, and above all, to the students of the Bible. The information that has been derived from the papyri of Egypt supports the sections of the historical books of the Bible, which describe the relations of the Hebrews with the Egyptians in a very remarkable manner and attests their general accuracy, even in details. Men could now confidently decipher the Egyptian scripts and understand the language of old. One of the kings they discovered was a pharaoh who founded the 22nd dynasty of Egypt, who was ruling in the 10th century BC. His name is Pharaoh Shishunk I, and his name and image is engraved on a temple in Karnak in Upper Egypt. He came from a line of printers of Libyan tribal descent, whose title was Great Chief of the Meshwesh, and the Egyptian historian Manetho says the family came from Babastis in the Eastern Delta. But his name is not just preserved in Egyptian texts. It has also been preserved in the books of the language of the Near East. The Bible has been highly discredited by disgruntled Western intellectuals, and their arguments have been embraced by the Black Conscious movement. But while men still search the earth for a missing link, the science of archaeology continues to verify the authenticity of the Bible. In 1 Kings chapter 11 and verse 40, it reads that Solomon sought therefore to kill Jeroboam. And Jeroboam arose and fled into Egypt, and Shishak, known in the hieroglyphs as Shishunk, king of Egypt, and was in Egypt until the death of Solomon. Pharaoh Shishak was also mentioned in other passages of the Holy Scriptures when he invaded Jerusalem for their rebellion. The Black Conscious movement insists that the Bible is a white man's book, but can never explain what Egyptian pharaohs are doing in that book. The prophet Jeremiah records another pharaoh from the 26th dynasty, where it reads that the word of the Lord which came to Jeremiah the prophet against the Gentiles, against Egypt, against the army of Pharaoh Necho, king of Egypt, which was by the river Euphrates on Carchemish, which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, smote in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah. Here is a statue of Pharaoh Necho, and he is adorned in the usually pharaonic attire. Big feet, a costume that is above his knees, he is bare-chested, and he wears the pharaonic crown with the serpent in the center, and his name has been preserved in the Bible. A century after his death, his endeavors were recorded by the 5th century BC Greek historian Herodotus, who showed how far-reaching this pharaoh's military plans had stretched. Herodotus says that Psammetichus left a son, Necos, who succeeded him. It was Necos, also known as Necho, who began the construction of the canal to the Persian Gulf, a work afterwards completed by Darius the Persian. Then after a reign of 16 years, he died and was succeeded by his son, Psammis. Britain produced a number of scholars who specialized in Egyptian studies. Sir John Gardner Wilkinson, referred to as the father of British Egyptology, said, "For soon after Necho had defeated and killed Josiah, king of Judah, the king of Babylon smote his army in Carchemish and took from the Egyptians all that pertained to the king of Egypt, from the bounded torrent and the Syrian confines unto the river Euphrates." The University of Oxford is ranked the second in the world and the first in the UK, and it has produced a high standard of intellectuals. And one of them was a teacher on the staff, George Rawlinson. And he wrote a very powerful book called The History of Ancient Egypt, documenting the history also of Pharaoh Necho. Necho, who must have been tolerably advanced in years when he ascended the throne, was nevertheless one of the most enterprising and energetic of Egyptian rulers. Another Oxford scholar, Edward Pusey, wrote a book titled Daniel the Prophet, and he also records the military exploits of that pharaoh. Jehoiakim himself probably came to the throne in the middle of BC 609. For since Necho against Asher was probably in the spring when campaigns commonly began, Josiah, who was slain when Necho reached Megiddo, probably died in that spring. On a small side road called Malek Place, there is a museum that is a part of the University College London that is named after an English Egyptologist. It is called the Petrie Museum of Egyptian Archaeology. It can be quite difficult to find, and you can easily walk past it, but it houses a few Egyptian artifacts. It was named after Sir William Matthew Flinders Petrie, the Egyptologist who was the pioneer of systematic methodology in archaeology and preservation of artifacts. He was the Edwards Professor at Egyptology at University College London, and he published more than 40 large quarto volumes. He was the first to discover the importance of data gathering, but he was a strong proponent of eugenics, a pseudoscience that taught that racial purity can be preserved and improved by selective breeding. And he dedicated his head for the furtherance of those studies to the Royal College of Surgeons at London. But his body is buried in Jerusalem, where he died. He published a book titled Egypt and Israel. And despite his warped racial views, he said that Pharaoh Necho, king of Egypt in 609 BC, came up to fight the king of Assyria at Carchemish by the Euphrates, and Josiah went out against him. Necho tried to hold Syria, and 4 years later, in 605 BC, he again struck out to the Euphrates at Carchemish, but he was crushed by Nebuchadnezzar, and Egypt never again touched its old limits. Pharaoh Shishak and Pharaoh Necho are two of three Egyptian pharaohs mentioned by name in the Bible, and it was the discovery and deciphering of the Rosetta Stone that helped men to compare the writings of the Egyptians and the writings of the Bible at the same time period and showed that they both perfectly correlate. The Black Conscious Movement calls the Bible a white man's book, and secular Western critics call it a book of myths, but the evidence just continues to silence the critics. There is one more pharaoh mentioned, But to understand where he fits into time, we now need to look at the Near Eastern alphabets of the Middle East in the Orient. Heinrich Friedrich Wilhelm Jansenius, according to the Encyclopedia Britannica, was a German biblical critic and a highly important figure in Hebrew and other Semitic language studies. While a professor of theology, he inaugurated in Semitic language studies a modern philological approach where his Hebrew and Chaldee or Aramaic dictionary, sometimes called a lexicon, has taught generations of scholars, both secular and religious. The English alphabet can be traced to Psalms 119, that has been divided into the 22 consonants of the Hebrew alphabet that was derived from the East, mainly via the Canaanites and the Phoenicians. And it was Jansenius who also laid the basis for Semitic epigraphy, which is deciphering an inscription on a stone, statue, or coin, especially the Phoenician inscriptions that opened a wider door to the languages of the Near East in the Orient. There are two Assyrian monuments in the British Museum dated to the 9th century BC called the Kuruk Monoliths that are one of the four monuments with the name Israel engraved upon it. The Assyrian cuneiform writing it was written in was translated as a result of the foundation that was laid by Jansenius, who helped to bolster Assyrian studies. It was the English Assyriologist George Smith who translated those two Assyrian monoliths. He also discovered and translated the 7th century BC flood tablet from the Neo-Assyrian period that has been labeled the Epic of Gilgamesh, one of the oldest known written works of literature. But his mentor was Englishman Major General Sir Henry Crensrick Rawlinson, a man who has been titled as the father of Assyriology, who first translated the language of the Near East that was labeled by Thomas Hyde in 1700 as cuneiform, which means wedge-shaped. And that is why we can read that ancient language today. His fellow Assyriologist was the Right Honourable Sir Austin Henry Layard, an English traveller, archaeologist, cuneiformist, art historian, draftsman, collector, author, politician, and diplomat, according to Wikipedia. He wrote a book that documented Rawlinson's contributions, and in this book he said that Major Rawlinson has thus classed the Assyro-Babylonian writing into Primitive Babylonian, Achaemenid Babylonia, Medo-Assyrian, Assyrian, and Elamean. Sir Henry Crensrick Rawlinson's linguistic skills in the languages of the Near East was to be an asset to his younger brother, who recorded some of the most powerful kings in the 8th century BC in history, whose thirst for geopolitical domination was so strong that they landed a place in the Bible, in the most quoted book in the New Testament, the Book of Isaiah. The younger Rawlinson records that the great Sargon was the builder of Khorsabad and founder of the last and greatest Assyrian dynasty. Observe the other kings whose names are highlighted in red. Taharqa, whom Manetho had made the third Ethiopian king, established himself as sole ruler of Egypt in BC 698. And it appears to have been with him that Hezekiah negotiated when the continued existence of Judea was menaced by Sennacherib. Esarhaddon, the son of Sennacherib, succeeded him upon the throne in BC 681. The Dead Sea is a salt lake that is bordered by Jordan to the east and Israel and Palestine to the west. It is 400 meters below sea level and is the lowest point on earth covering a land surface. In the English-speaking Bible, it is called the Salt Sea and has been known as one of the world's first health resorts that was once used by Cleopatra for its healing abilities. Israel and Jordan have signed a $900 million deal to save it, for the scorching Middle Eastern heat from the sun has been rapidly drying it up in recent times. Why is it so important? It has 12 exclusive minerals that are exclusive to that sea alone, that can cure acne, eczema, psoriasis, and apparently joint pain and arthritis, where its properties can calm aching muscles and joints that can stimulate a natural circulation. It was at the Dead Sea that the best preserved scroll, 24 feet in length, the Book of Isaiah, was discovered in a cave by Bedouin shepherds in 1947 that records three main political powers. The Assyrian Empire once dominated the Near East. They were very powerful and brutal. Their level of artwork was of a high standard, carving monolithic images into solid rock with such precision and detail. When you carefully observe the high standard of art on their war scenes that dominated most of Assyrian art, you marvel at the genius of these men. They sure loved war and the sight of blood, whether it be men or the innocent lions that is regularly featured in their art. They were depicted as having very big stylish beards, and when they conquered the Greek Cypriots of southern Europe, these Greeks also adopted the big beards of their conquerors. The first Assyrian king mentioned by name in the Book of Isaiah was Sargon II. He founded the Near Assyrian Empire, and he is seen on the left with the Assyrian crown that has been adopted by the successive dynasty of popes. He was succeeded by his son Sennacherib, whose name means Sin has replaced the brothers. Sin was the Assyrian moon god. It was the English Assyriologist George Smith who reintroduced to the modern world the history of Sennacherib when he deciphered the Assyrian cuneiform inscriptions that mentioned his name and recorded in a book that strengthened the historical authenticity of the Bible, especially the Book of Isaiah. When Sennacherib invaded Judah, that was recorded in the Book of Isaiah. There is a room in the British Museum dedicated to that conflict, and reading the Bible is one thing. But when you can visually see the events and their kings, it electrifies the words you're reading on ink on a white background. During diplomatic relations between Israel and Assyria, there is an artifact in the British Museum that records King Hezekiah paying tribute money of silver to the Assyrian king Sennacherib. And this is exactly what is recorded in 2 Kings chapter 18 verses 14 and 15, proving over again that the Bible is historically accurate. In late 2015, a number of newspapers in the English-speaking world recorded that another artifact discovered verify the importance and accuracy of the Book of Isaiah. It was the seal of King Hezekiah of Judah. The 2,700-year-old artifact is the first time that a seal impression of an Israelite, a Judean king, has ever come to light in a scientific archaeological excavation. King Merodach-Baladan of Babylon struck a diplomatic deal with Hezekiah, and God was not pleased at all, for Hezekiah just wanted to show off his bling. But despite his failings, shortcomings, and his sometimes lack of faith, this reformer was described in an exact similar light as his grandson, another reformer, Josiah. Now it came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, son of Ela, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. He trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor any that were before him. King Hezekiah's foe Sennacherib's army was wiped out by an angel, according to Isaiah chapter 37 and verse 36, 185,000 men. Then Sennacherib was killed by his own sons. There is always a price to pay when you war against God's people. And Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his stead. But during his war with the Assyrians, Hezekiah formed an alliance with an African king whose army was to weaken the Assyrians and help to preserve the kingdom of Judah. The Assyrians were vexed and said to Hezekiah, "Lo, thou trustest in the staff of this broken reed on Egypt, whereon if a man lean, it will go into his hand and pierce it. So is Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to all that trust in him." Who is this third Pharaoh that is mentioned in the Bible? "And he heard say concerning, to Harka, king of Ethiopia, he has come forth to make war with thee. And when he heard it, he sent messengers to Hezekiah, saying, Western libraries are virtually scant on books on African history. But the Bible preserved the name of one of its most famous rulers, Taharqa of the 20th dynasty of Egypt. This African king from modern-day Sudan was a military genius. His bust showed him as having a very youthful face. He looks quite happy and quite content. And it was his military intervention in the Middle East, as well as the angel wiping out the Assyrian army, that brought stability to Judah when the nation temporarily feared for their life. For all his military endeavors, Taharqa's name is rarely mentioned as one of the great rulers of history. Even most Bible dictionaries delete him out of their records. Studying African history is hard, you really have to dig. But you will always find the odd document that preserves authentic history. In the February 2008 edition of National Geographic, there is a very interesting article on the black pharaohs of the 25th dynasty of Egypt, and it mentions Taharqa's military intervention. The deliverance of Jerusalem is not just another of ancient history's delights, but one of its pivotal moments. It has been easy to overlook, amid these towering historical events, the dark-skinned figure at the edge of the landscape, the survivor of El Teca, the hard-charging prince later referred to by the Assyrians as the one accursed by all the great gods, Pi's son, Taharqa. The 31-year-old military commander who received the crown in Memphis in 690 and presided over the combined empires of Nubia and Egypt for the next 26 years did not intend to sit on his profits. During his rule, to travel down the Nile from Naparta to Thebes was to navigate a panorama of architectural wonderment. Without defacing a single pre-existing monument, Taharqa made Thebes his. He did the same hundreds of miles upriver in the Nubian city of Naparta. English Egyptologist Sir William Matthew Flinders Petrie, in his Egypt and Israel, says that the campaign of Sennacherib in Judea in 701 BC, where Taharqa is named as being king of Ethiopia, and Hezekiah was warned against trusting him. Taharqa was not sole sovereign till 693 at the death of Shabataka, but he had been sent down to Egypt at the age of 20 as viceroy. Building on that foundation was a book published in 1926 by an African-American female author by the name of Drusilla Dungy Houston. The book is titled The Wonderful Ethiopians of the Ancient Kushite Empire. She carefully studied the life of Taharqa by reading the writings of Strabo, the Greek geographer, philosopher, and historian, and Sir William Matthew Flinders Petrie, and she catalogued the history of this king. She tells us that the archives of the past hold the facts. The excavations of Petrie revealed in Egypt the remains of a distinct race that preceded the historic Egyptians. The ancients called this pioneer race which lit the torch of art and science, Kushite Ethiopians. One of these conquerors, Taharqa, carried his expedition in Asia. 693 BC, Taharqa conquered the whole Nile Valley. Thebes welcomed him with enthusiasm. Priests opened the gates of Memphis. He fixed his capital at Thebes. Strabo said that Taharqa rivaled Ramses II in his conquests, which extended westward to the Pillars of Hercules and eastward to the Assyrian domains. According to Strabo, Taharqa even rivals Ramses II, so his military endeavors must have been very, very far-stretched indeed. The deciphering of the Rosetta Stone that helped to unlock the ancient Egyptian language helped to decipher the text on this monument of Taharqa, king of Ethiopia, that is situated in the Sudan. In Egypt is the famous Karnak Temple complex, in the Great Hypostyle Hall. These colossus monuments are one of the most visited monuments of ancient Egypt by tourists. Instead of defacing or demolishing it, Saharqa built a number of monuments outside of it to add on to the artwork of earlier dynasties in Egypt. In the Sudan, where Saharqa is buried, there are more pyramids there than there are in Egypt. But because of the West's early fascination with Egypt, the Kushite Empire in the Sudan has been eclipsed by the hype of its northern neighbor. But there is one scholar who rescued its history from oblivion. English historian George Rawlinson was one of those rare intellectuals that you'll not find ever again. The narrator searched for years for his books, and he is one of the only few intellectual giants who could align secular and religious history with an intellectual depth and without a racial bias. That is very rare. He translated the writings of Herodotus from its original language in Greek into English, and put footnotes documented Sennacherib's failure and the Kushite's triumph. Herodotus calls all blacks under Egypt Ethiopians, and this is what he calls the indigenous population of the Sudan. Afterwards, therefore, when Sennacherib, king of the Arabians and Assyrians, marched his vast army into Egypt, the warriors one and all refused to come to his aid. The country above Elephantine is inhabited by Ethiopians, who possessed one half of this island. The Egyptians occupy the other. Above the island there is a great lake, the shores of which are inhabited by Ethiopian nomads. After pressing it, you come again to the stream of the Nile, which runs into the lake. The Nile flows out of Libya, through Ethiopia, into Egypt. When the south declines towards the setting sun lies the country of Ethiopia, the last inhabited land in that direction. There gold is obtained in great plenty. Huge elephants abound with wild trees of all sorts and ebony. And the men are taller, handsomer, and longer lived than anywhere else. In their customs they differ greatly from the rest of mankind, and particularly in the way they choose their kings. For they find out the man who is the tallest of all the citizens, and of strength equal to his height, and appoint him to rule over them. Rawlinson said, compare what Herodotus said pertaining to their height to Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 14. The labor of Egypt and the merchandise of Ethiopia and of the Sabaeans, men of stature, shall come over to thee. Herodotus tells us that the epicenter of the Sudanese culture was a great city called Meroe, which is said to be the capital of the other Ethiopians. When you look at Saharqa's homeland today, it is ruined by war. You would never believe that this country was once a powerful empire. The consistent negative images of the Sudan and the rest of Africa leaves a deep-rooted mental image that stays tucked away in the subconscious, making it very difficult for anyone to ever take antiquity studies on this culture seriously. And anyone who has at least a basic knowledge of media or advertising is aware that imagery can shape and influence our perceptions. But Sudan's negative presentation has deep roots. On a road in London called Bentinck Street was one of the best historians in English history, who lived during the Enlightenment period in the 1700s. His name was Edward Gibbon, famous for writing that huge volume, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. Though a very gifted and fine historian, his views of black Africans, especially in the Sudan, were a reflection of an age where they could go unchallenged. But when you carefully read what he says, you can get a picture of why the black conscious movement see Christianity as European imperialism, totally ignoring what Jesus actually had to say. Gibbon said, during several ages, the bishops of Nubia were named and consecrated by the Jacobite Patriarch of Alexandria. As late as the 12th century, Christianity prevailed, and some rites, some ruins are still visible in the savage towns of Sana'a and Dongola. A metaphysical religion may appear too refined for the capacity of the Negro race, Gibbon said. In the British Museum, there are a number of artifacts that are a reminder of the little-known Christian culture in the Sudan before it collapsed and was overrun or replaced by Islam in the north. Here are the remains of a Christian temple or church in ancient Nubia, which is modern-day Sudan. Very few people know about this church. You can see the pagan influences of the mother and child images with this Sudanese Coptic bishop, whose name is Marianos. And on the left is a crowned Nubian queen in royal robes and a scepter in her hand, dated to around the 12th century AD. What Gibbons said about these blacks is why the Black Conscious Movement is very hostile to Christianity. They can't distinguish between what the Bible says and what people do or say. Edward Gibbons said that the hand of nature has flattened the noses of the Negroes, covered their head with shaggy wool, and tinged their skin with inherent and indelible blackness. Christianity had raised that nation above the level of African barbarism, a people of savage Negroes, into the system of civilized society. In the following century, the Prussian archaeologist Carl Richard Lepsius was adamant that the Kushites belonged to the Caucasian race, and that the black pharaohs of the Sudan were not even black at all. He was followed by an American Egyptologist, George Reisner. Though the artifact stared him in the face, he said it was absolutely impossible that black Africans could construct the monuments he was excavating, and was also adamant that they were not even black people. Now, these are deep-rooted prejudices, but we just have to look at the facts. For social media is full of people who give their opinions but do not actually document what they say. And now, many archaeologists not necessarily glorifying the paganism of early cultures, but giving history and cultures their rightful place, are approaching Sudan and its history with a far more intelligent approach. Let us compare prejudice versus facts. The British Museum houses artifacts of the black Kushite nobility from the Sudan, from princesses to pharaohs, and it is very strange that these archaeologists couldn't identify what race they were. In the tombs were discovered tablets that are made of copper, bronze, gold, jasper, lapis lazuli, faience, chalcedony, and calcite, written in hieroglyphs. But the blacks of the Sudan had their own unique Meroitic script, the oldest written sub-Saharan language, and it still has not been deciphered. The Griffith Institute at the University of Oxford is named after the man who made the earliest attempts to decipher it, Francis Llewellyn Griffith, professor of Egyptology at the University of Oxford, who established the sand valleys for the signs by comparing the Meroitic inscriptions with the ancient Egyptian. Though the Rosetta Stone has been cracked and decoded, the Meroitic script still remains quite a mystery, and they are on display throughout the British Museum in the Nubian section. But recently, archaeologists are beginning to discover that there were times in their history that Egypt and the Sudan were once one, and there was no difference between them, and many intermarriages took place, as discovered by this archaeologist at Purdue University. This papyri from the 14th century BC shows a Kushite noble who was buried in the Valley of the Kings. An autopsy was done on his body to see whether he had suffered heart disease or not, and it was only when they discovered the papyri that scholars grudgingly admitted he was from Nubia. This painting is from a tomb, TT40, by a viscera of Kush under Tutankhamun named Amenhotep, who that is also dated to the 14th century BC. The entourage of black Kushites of different shades of brown, some jet black and others are mid-brown. They had braided hair, which is dyed brown or red. They had earrings, white linen outfit, and most with a feather in their heads, sandals on their feet, and a huge abundance of gold is exactly how the Greek historian Herodotus described that culture. The front men have two feathers in their head that is symbolic of light and air, and they are seen on the heads of the Egyptian gods Ra and Osiris. Most of the early art of black Kushites is dependent on what the Egyptians left behind in their tombs. And as African history heavily follows the oral tradition, early written records are quite scant. But the debate that has been raging on in recent years is, which one was the older out of the two? Every journal says that they arose around the same time, but Sudan borrowed her culture from Egypt. But we have to stick to facts. An early incense burner was discovered in the Sudan. It doesn't look like much, but on closer observation, it has the earliest representation of a pharaoh, and King Taharqa came from this lineage. This is how the New York Times described this incense burner in 1979. It reads that ancient Nubian artifacts yield evidence of the earliest monarchy, not in Egypt, but in the Sudan. The new findings suggest that the ancient Nubians may have reached this stage of political development as long ago as 3300 BC, several generations before the earliest documented Egyptian king. On the incense burner, which was broken and had to be pieced together, was a depiction of a palace facade, a crowned king sitting on a throne in a boat, a royal standard before the king, and hovering above the king, the falcon god, Horus. Most of the images are ones commonly associated with kingship in later Egyptian traditions. The majestic figure on the incense burner, Dr. Williams said, is the earliest known representation of a king in the Nile Valley. His name is unknown, but he is believed to have lived approximately three generations of kings before the time of Scorpion, the earliest known Egyptian ruler. So from a historical perspective, the Black Kushite culture of the Sudan preceded the Egyptian one, and this painting dated to around 2100 BC shows that the attire of the Kushites was not borrowed from the Egyptians but was already theirs, and Taharqa did not inherit a culture from Egypt but one that belonged to his ancestors. Very few scholars will admit this, but on Battersea Park Road in southwest London once lived a man by the name of John Richard Archer, whose mother was an white Irish and his father was a black Barbadian from the Caribbean. In the London Daily Express in 1913, the middle article at the top shows him as the first black mayor of London, and the picture below shows him on the right and his black Canadian wife on the left. Like George Rawlinson, he had a biblical worldview and was able to align the writings of the Bible with the writings of the Greeks and confirm that Egyptian culture was from the Sudan. "We come from an ancient race," he said. "We have a history to be proud of. Before Romulus founded Rome, before Homer sang, when Greece was in its infancy and the world quite young, Hori Mero was the chief city of the Negroes along the Nile. Its private and public buildings, its market and public squares, its colossus walls and stupendous gates, its gorgeous chariots and alert footmen, its inventive genius and ripe scholarship made it the cradle of civilization and the mother of art. Egypt borrowed her light from the venerable Negroes up the Nile. Greece went to school to the Egyptians, and Rome turned to Greece for law and the science of warfare. England had dug down into Rome centuries to establish a government and maintain it. Jeremiah the prophet asks, can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard his spots? We have, in addition to this testimony, the evidence of Herodotus, Homer, Josephus, Eusebius, Strabo, and others, and I am content to accept their evidence. Here is our ancient past." The United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, better known as UNESCO, have solidified what John Richard Archer has said. They specialize in protecting old ancient cultures, which they call World Heritage Sites, and this is how they have described the culture of ancient Sudan. Since antiquity, the hill of Gibel Barkal has been strongly associated with religious traditions and folklore. The Egyptians believed that their state god Amun resided in this holy mountain, so they traced their religion to the Sudan. The pyramids, palaces, temples, burial chambers, and funerary chapels at Gibel Barkal, and the sites of the Napatan region and their related beliefs, writings, and painted scenes on walls represent a masterpiece of creative genius, demonstrating the artistic, social, political, and religious values of a human group for more than 2,000 years. The corbel vaults of the tombs of Karu constitute a new building technique which influenced Mediterranean architecture from the 7th century BC onwards, so they also heavily influenced European culture, as John Archer said. In terms of their architecture, the sites of the Napatan region testify to the revival of a once almost universal religion and related language, the Egyptian old script, and the worship of the state god Amun. The site is connected with the greatest kings of the Middle Nile region, whose political power extended up to the Egyptian Delta and Palestine. One of their famous rulers, Taharqa, is the only Sudanese sovereign mentioned by name in the Old Testament. The evidence collated verifies the historical authenticity of the Bible over again. And what is very interesting, that even books from the Black conscious community, like They Came Before Columbus, quotes from the Bible and mentions Taharqa many, many times to validate its own historical authenticity. Not bad for a slave trading white man's book. To summarize, let us look at ground we have covered. We have proven from secular history, journals, manuscripts, archaeology, Egyptology, Assyriology, politicians, soldiers, university scholars, philologists, scientists, and priceless artifacts in museums that the Bible is historically accurate. We have seen that major wars determine the outcome of history and shape the future of the world. We have looked at the importance of studying history, and to have a balanced view of a historical event or individual, you have to follow the divine mandate of two or three witnesses, and you can either hold on to an outdated prejudice and feel comfortable in your ignorance, or you can investigate the facts and let the evidence explain itself. In our next study, we will look at books that is justifying blacks to go back into Freemasonry, and we will carefully analyze the arguments from the black leaders and their war against Jesus.
Jesus was born under strange circumstances, and she had to be put away privily, as the Bible teaches, because if she were seen pregnant, the law was, where's the husband? Where's the father? Well, you say Holy Ghost, but we know there's no human being born without the agency of a man. That's real.
As the narrator always encourages, please research for yourself everything that is presented. Feel free to subscribe to the Even at the Doors YouTube channel, where you'll receive regular videos. And you can follow us on Facebook and Twitter by clicking on the links below. I would just like to thank all those who have sent donations that have kept this ministry afloat. And if you would like to continue to support this work, also click on the link below. If you would like to see this work spread even further, you have permission to distribute this video for non-commercial or commercial use on the condition that you do not add or take away from the content of this study. Thank you.